substance or behaviour. My addictive substance was alcohol. Still would be if I went back for another bit of research or convincing about my ism of alcoholism. And my behaviour equally disruptive at the extremes of intense action or nothing, as I got really into the malady of the ism. So why? Sometimes we ask the question, why me? And I don't deserve this. And I heard this quite a lot over the last day or two. And the answer is, why not? Why not me? Why not be an alcoholic? And why? Well, if we found something which seems to do the trick, to fix us, to make us convivial, part of, feel included, feel a part of life, and be able to strive for perfection, the perfection that we thought other people wanted from us, and also the perfection that we were determined to follow in anything that we did. And the answer really was just to keep things in proportion, keep life in proportion, to make progress and not strive for the impossible. It doesn't mean we shouldn't strive. It means we need to know what is possible and what is not possible. So my drinking story, 35 years long, from joyful, convivial, relaxed, happy, or sad, as the drink allowed me to express or emote, to have emotions. Because if I didn't drink, what would happen? Well, fear would come back, I guess. It was always my constant companion, not knowing how to live life. So drink was a really good enabler to let me free to extremes and trying to fit in, trying to feel included, trying to have the right place to live, have the right car, have the right job, have the right girl, have the right material things, and still inside a desperate loneliness and a misunderstanding about what life was about. So maybe I just felt less than and didn't know how to feel just equal to other people. And what I've realised is, in this life, it's not about what we deserve. That's just a fantasy. We are here to make the best of what is, to live life as it is today. So recovery is a 24-hour a day programme for me. And what's made it possible? Well, the love of other people, my family, community, the help of professionals, and understanding what is possible today rather than striving for the impossible, to know everything. And now I realise the more I know, the less I know, and that's a gift. That's a real gift in this sobriety. If I start the day with low expectations or no expectations, I'm very surprised by the end of it what has happened. And what has happened by the end of the day is I know a little bit more about me and who I am, so I don't need to know the full picture, and never can. And, you know, the gift of all of this is, I can be sensible about what is possible. What keeps me in recovery? Helps me change my attitude and behaviour on a daily basis to whatever level is possible. Well, family, friends, community, and sobriety seems to be dependent on my spiritual and emotional condition. My spiritual condition is as life offers and is, so my connection to the moment of now, my spiritual, is living in the moment of reality. And my emotions, or sorting out my emotions on a daily basis, how am I feeling, why, what can I do, is again looking at the possible rather than the impossible. So what do I deserve today? I deserve to give myself a break for being human and getting help from people who can understand where I'm coming from. And that help normally comes in the shape of people in the fellowship of AA, Alcoholics Anonymous, and family, and community, and professionals. But people in fellowship know what addiction is all about. That is, the impossibility of stopping on my own. Well, is that true? I don't know. All I know is I couldn't do it on my own. So what is possible today? To keep sober one day at a time, and to do that I lean on fellowship, and the fellowship is a collection of unique, authentic people, not special and different, just unique and authentic, with a unique, authentic view on their own personal view on life, and we share this similarity of sobriety. And that seems to work, impossibly as it sounds, that a diverse group of people can get together and keep sober and not argue too much, although we do, but we just get on. So what is AA? I share the statement of intent and then I share some of the literature of AA to illustrate what's going on for me. And these videos are all about experience, strength and hope, and sharing a message often when people can't get to a meeting or just simply need a little bit of reassurance. So it's okay to be an addict in recovery, and for me it wouldn't be okay to go and do some research, and this is why I don't do it. So what is AA? Alcoholics Anonymous is a fellowship of men and women who share their experience, strength and hope with each other that they may solve their common problem and help others to recover from alcoholism. The only requirement for membership is a desire to stop drinking. There are no dues or fees for AA membership. We are self-supporting through our own contributions. AA is not allied with any sect, denomination, politics, organisation or institution. It does not wish to engage in any controversy, neither endorses nor opposes any causes. Our primary purpose is to stay sober and help other alcoholics to achieve sobriety. And when the fellowship was started, many years ago, it was decades now, about 8 years, it was all about diversity and respecting people's beliefs and understandings about life. And the 12 steps of action for an individual, all about changing attitude and behaviour. And there are 12 traditions, which are all about unity, service and recovery. So in order to keep well, we have to share it, to give and not expect anything back. And so this thing of, what do I deserve in life? Maybe just a break to make good my life as best I can, to whatever level it goes. And if I try to control it, or if I try and manipulate my life, or contrive it to what I think it ought to be, and I don't get my way, and then I say to myself, I'm going to hand it over to God and see what happens. I need to understand the possibilities of a higher power. And the possibilities of higher power for me is to find the truth of now, the possible. So for me, God is truth. And if I can't find wisdom from the inner voice, I ask other people, help me understand my situation, and in fellowship or with a sponsor or with a group of people, I'm going to get clarity through expressing my truth so other people can help me, so God works through people. And if our motives are right, if our motives are clear, we love people and they can love us back. So for me, God is truth, God works through others, works through people, and God is love. So I need to listen and not to look for what I deserve and then ask God to sort it out for me. Unless the message comes back through a human, probably. Or who knows? But that's just how I see it. And everybody's entitled to their own view. And thank goodness for that. Time is short. On January the 20th, it says in this book, Daily Reflections, we pause and ask. As we go through the day, we pause when agitated or doubtful and ask for the right thought or action. And then there's a big paragraph which I haven't got time to read, and I've probably covered it. But the most important thing is, it's not about getting my way. Self will run riot. All about step one. Powerless over people, places, things, and powerless over my addiction if I go back for some more convincing. And anger and resentments will kill me and put me back in the problem. So the gift for me today is, whenever things are not going quite right, the right thought and action is often the serenity prayer to God or to good conscience to give me clarity and ask others, God, grant me the serenity to accept the things I cannot change, courage to change the things I can, and the wisdom to know the difference is for me always just in the day. Recovery from addiction to either substance or behaviour. And my substance, alcohol, my behaviour for 35 years, trying to be perfect and far from it, either in work, life, home life, family life, relationships, never perfect, always learning. and probably learning some of the things which these days learning some of the things which I never really understood too well. And those are my feelings. So when I wake up in the morning these days, I ask myself, before I get too far ahead in the day, how am I feeling, why, and what may I do? So how am I feeling today? Well, I still have a big gap inside me, and that's because the relationship has ended, and I'm hoping that she is okay, and that I will be, as time affords. So my primary purpose at the moment is not to fill the gap inside me with other experiences which are not going to help me in the long term. And the easy way to fill in the gap when we've finished one relationship is maybe to idly think we ought to be in another one, or feel we ought to be in another one, or feel we need to go back to the one we were in. And those sort of conundrums can go round and round in one's head. And that means we're just human. We're just human about feeling the loss and grieving a relationship. So we all go through denials around, I can't believe it's like this. It's very frustrating. I could be angry, and sometimes I feel that anger would help me. But I don't feel angry towards the other person in this. I feel like I've let myself down in some way, and that's just me knocking myself down in order maybe to build myself up a bit. And, you know, it's easy to get into a downward spiral. And I, what I've learned in recovery is it's better to desist from pen and tongue and text messages and doing too much to upset another person who's trying to find their own path. It's hard enough in recovery, and we need not upset others, and we deal with our upset as we may, deal with the gap that's been left, grieve as we may, just one day at a time. So it would be extraordinary to be able to forget and then try to start again in something new too quickly. So I prefer the gap, and maybe fill it with a bit of reading, which I did this morning, or this book, Alcoholics Anonymous. And this is the big blue book. It's like the it's not a Bible, it's a set of tools. It's a set of writing about tools and instruments of how to keep sober one day at a time. And the most important aspects of this book is understanding the nature of the malady of alcoholism, and then what we may do on a daily basis to keep it in the day and not drinking. And the whole fellowship of AA, Alcoholics Anonymous, is simply about a desire not to drink. And it reads like this on this little card, available at meetings or from other venues if you know where to look, or off the internet. And it says about AA, Alcoholics Anonymous is a fellowship of men and women who share their experience, strength and hope with each other that they may solve their common problem and help others to recover from alcoholism. The only requirement for membership is a desire to stop drinking. There are no dues or fees for AA membership. We are self-supporting through our own contributions. AA is not allied with any sect, denomination, politics, organisation or institution. It does not wish to engage in any controversy, neither endorses nor opposes any causes. Our primary purpose is to stay sober and help other alcoholics to achieve sobriety. And, you know, sobriety is just one day long. As I said yesterday, the life sentence of not drinking is simply one day long. And the gift is, if we stop drinking, we have this other gap inside us, on the emotional and spiritual side, of something to fill with good things, which is the good of life and the good of living, and picking up on interests maybe we've had over the years. And yesterday, there were a couple of meetings I went to, one at St. Philip's, which is near Earl's Court, not far away from here, and the other one was in the Boltons. And the lunchtime meeting was all about experience, strength and hope, what a person has done to make their life work. And on this occasion it was about a person who was 20 years sober, who had felt that life had come to an end 20 years ago, and actually finding the fellowship and outside help as well. So it wasn't just the fellowship, it was outside help as well, helped them find a way forward. And in the meetings over the last few days, much has been said about anonymity, and for me, anonymity is simply the sanctuary to find our spiritual truth. So spiritual for me is very much about truth, the truth of now, and being in the moment with less denials and less filters. And as one Archbishop said, when asked what is spiritual, he said it's simply the ability to cope with now. So if now is all about reality, we have a better chance on a daily basis to improve our lives. And if we have gaps inside us, emotionally, spiritually, and also in something with something to do which is useful, then we have opportunity to put ourselves to good use and do something which is valuable to ourselves and to other people. So I've done a bit of reading from AA this morning, the doctor's opinion, which I thoroughly enjoyed reading again, simply because it tells me I have a malady which needs help, and it needs help on a daily basis, or I might slide back into taking drink. If I took drink, what would happen? Life would become unmanageable and very horrible very, very quickly. So I can at the moment cope with what is going on for me. And the other books I use on these videos is As Bill Sees It, which I'm back to the beginning of, and the Daily Reflections book, which gives a one-page, one-day reading. So starting off with the Daily Reflections, it says, we pause and ask. As we go through the day, we pause when agitated or doubtful and ask for the right thought or action. So we pause and we stop reacting, we start responding. Today I humbly ask my higher power for the grace to find the space between my impulse and my action, to let flow a cooling breeze when I would respond with heat, to interrupt fierceness with gentle peace, to accept the moment which allows judgment to become discernment, to defer to silence when my tongue would rush to attack or defend. I promise to watch for every opportunity to turn turn toward my higher power for guidance. I know where this power is. It resides within me, as clear as a mountain brook, hidden in the hills. It is the unsuspected inner resource. I thank my higher power for this world of light and truth I see when I allow it to direct my vision. I trust it today and hope it trusts me to make all effort to find the right thought or action today. And for me, you know, I was at a step meeting last night, and it was all about, came to believe that a power greater than me could restore me to sanity. And, you know, if I can get to the truth without filters or denials, get to the truth. And for me, I have a very practical version of God. God is truth and love, and God works through people. So it's an appeal to good conscience in all of those respects. So I haven't understood it any more than that. And the gift is, we don't have to understand it as you or someone else may understand it. You just understand your own higher power. So nobody's allowed to tell you what your higher power is. You can make whatever it is suit you. And I utilize, in the best way, the wisdom learned over the years from the fellowship of AA, from medical people around, from my family and society. And we all become unique and authentic in that. And we only have one similarity, and that's a simple desire not to drink. So coming on to As Bill Sees It, it says pain and progress. Yes, pain. I've had some of that this week. Years ago I used to commiserate with all people who suffered. Now I commiserate only with those who suffer in ignorance, who do not understand the purpose and ultimate utility of pain. Someone once remarked that pain is the touchstone of spiritual progress. How heartily we AAs can agree with him, for we know that the pains of alcoholism had to come before sobriety, and emotional turmoil before serenity. Believe more deeply, hold your face up to the light, even though for the moment you do not see. And that is so true, because it's taken me a while in recovery just to make sense of being alive, let alone anything else. And the gratitude I have over the last few years to live life without a drink inside me, one day at a time, so I understand my emotional state, my spiritual connection to now, and my physical abilities, capacities and incapacities. And in recovery I've had a few incapacities come my way and disable me from being the person I used to be, quite as I was. And clinical depression and type 1 diabetes are quite difficult on a daily basis, and I do my best. So for me this morning, the Big Blue Book, did some reading from that, As Bill Sees It, and just for today. But my clearest message, if any, is that although we call it in the program anonymity is suggested to be the spiritual foundation, I feel it provides sanctuary and the spiritual foundation of life. I better just say again, just for the benefit of anybody just finding this video out of the bunch that I do. My video is all about recovery from addiction to substance or behaviour. So my substance, alcohol, my behaviour, slipped for 35 years trying to be perfect. And in relationships, work, the environment, community, society, never perfect, never near perfect, never will be. And that's the gift. We keep on learning all the time if we allow ourselves the luxury to be wrong. Or not wrong, but just mistaken, or not mistaken, just having a different opinion at a time and then changing it. And one of the big areas that everybody talks about is the anonymity of Alcoholics Anonymous. And I have here a little card which says, what does anonymity mean? So this is for anonymity, and then my understanding of what anonymity means to me. It says, members of Alcoholics Anonymous make a point of carrying the message about their own recovery in AA on a person-to-person basis, but never disclose the membership of others, and I wholeheartedly agree with that. In this way, they may serve as examples of recovery and thus stimulate active alcoholics to seek help. And the trouble is, we don't actually go to wet places most often to actually go stimulate alcoholics to join us, active ones, that is. In public media, however, such as TV, radio, films and press, AA traditions urge members to maintain strict anonymity for three reasons. We have learned from our own experience that the active alcoholic will shun any source of help which might reveal his identity. Quite true. Two, past events indicate that those alcoholics who seek public recognition as AA members may drink again. Anybody in AA may drink again. Three, public attention and publicity for individual members of AA would invite self-serving competition and conflict over different personal views. Well, the problem is that we go to AA for one common purpose, and that's a desire to stop drinking, and stop drinking on a daily basis. And the absolute truth is, people remain unique, authentic human beings with their own outlook. That's the gift of sobriety for me, that everybody is different with one similarity. And it's diversity, and we need diversity in our lives, or we will founder, and we will not succeed. Anonymity in public media guards the unity of AA members and preserves the attraction of the program for the millions who still need help. And, you know, the most attractive thing about AA, I found, was that it was full of human beings, all making mistakes on a daily basis and still staying sober. So, what do we do if somebody relapses who might be in the public eye? Well, people within AA don't really comment on it. They just say welcome back if they come back. And to the outside world, what does the outside world care about Alcoholics Anonymous really, other than the few individuals who might be in the public eye already? And what I've learned on YouTube and other websites is people who have a desire to stop drinking or know they have a problem are most likely to have a look and see what's on the internet. If you're not an alcoholic, why on earth would you go looking for people on websites or in the media or the press who are alcoholics? Is it so that they can be judged? That's the question for other people, but for people in the fellowship or people returning to the fellowship, anonymity can cause real problems. Inasmuch, if you go out again, having found that you can be sober for a while, and then the environment, the experience of life has put you back in a place where you've relapsed, what you don't need is people coming up to you and saying, well, I could have told you that, or do the steps and you'll be alright, or any other sort of advice. What we need is for people to keep coming back and work out how to stay sober one day only. And what I've said is, in my last video, this book, AA, provides an understanding of the malady and also how other people have made it one day at a time through experience, strength and hope. And this is what the AA meetings are all about, simply experience, strength and hope. And on the back of the card it talks about Tradition 11. Our public relations policy is based on attraction rather than promotion. We need always maintain personal anonymity at the level of press, radio and films. So why do I don't flout that particularly. But I do have a view of what anonymity does for me. In the rooms of AA, and with my sponsor, and with people who know me in my confidential life, I can share the absolute truth of me. And that's my sanctuary. So when people go to AA, the anonymity provides absolute sanctuary to find out what is going on in your head, or my head, so that we may try keep this day a sober day. So anonymity is critical, I believe, to the success of the program for individuals. So I would not want to undermine anonymity, but I would question if anonymity is a spiritual foundation. It's just my question, it's not anybody else's in an AA. I don't know, do I? Because everybody has their own opinion, and often people keep their opinions to themselves, and that's all to the good. So for me, where it says anonymity is the spiritual foundation for all our traditions, actually anonymity provides sanctuary for people to find their truth. And the truth for me is the absolute understanding of reality. Reality as it is now, with less denials and less filters. So the more we find truth, which is spiritual for me, or the ability to cope, then I feel that we're on a good path. If, however, we were to be in a place of dogma, we would be challenging each other on our anonymity ad infinitum, because we all hold different religious understandings, or actual understandings of what spiritual is as well. So whilst I am happy with my understanding of spiritual being the ability to cope with real life, reality, in the moment of now, that is the truth of now, and that, as Gandhi said, God is truth, that all works for me, but it might not work for the rest of the planet. And actually, the rest of the planet is entitled, quite rightly, to their own point of view. We are all free to make our choices, no bigger, no smaller are we than any other person, even when we might feel, because society has a different view, that we are less than others or more than others. That is a real trap and will take us back to drinking in no time if we don't understand we need only keep sober one day at a time, be the same size, no bigger, no smaller. Find this truth, which can be so elusive. Enough. But it's been on my mind, always it is on my mind. Am I breaking something by suggesting that anonymity is sanctuary? Am I breaking some misunderstanding by others that truth is spiritual? Most likely, but that's as best I can do for today. And we are entitled to our own opinions, and equally we need respect others. So, you know, fellowship is a broad church of people, and also just a broad group, community, society, a fellowship. It's not an organisation, and it cannot fix you. Well, there we go. A little bit extra this morning.